fans at planetloud.tv.
Today's our third day of the Black Mass tour right now. Last night was freaking amazing. We were in London last night at Brixton Academy, and dude, I don't know, I think my hair is still singed from all the fire.
Yeah, it was a good time.
Yeah, it was killer. Yeah. We went to the strip club last night afterwards. We went to Secrets, thank you Jane, for the hospitality.
Always a good time.
Jane's the owner of Secrets. She treats us very well.
Tour, doing this. I mean, we're in Southampton today, and it's just every day, you know, we just keep going. And after this, I think about we leave the UK October 18th. We head back to the States. We finish up a full statewide tour. That takes us just until about Christmas time. And then next year we do, I think, Europe and South America and Australia.
Dude, we're booked till not this Christmas, like next Christmas. We haven't announced it, so everybody's watching this. We haven't announced it yet, but we'll be in your city, your country, everywhere. Yeah. I mean, world tour. I mean, I tweet stuff about Instagram, stuff about world tour, but we'll be everywhere this year. Other, like, actually, countries we haven't even played at before. So, yeah, like Russia, we'll see you. Russia, the chicks are hot.
Yeah,
chicks are amazing. Russia,
all the new places we've never been.
Yeah. So we'll be doing South America again. All your South American fans, you know, we appreciate all your tweets and stuff you send us. You know, when you guys all get together as an entire group and have Black Mole Brides Day. Yeah, we'll be seeing you soon as well. But yeah, after the first of this year. Okay. So lots of partying.
Yeah.
World tour party,
and we're only day three into it. Yeah. Even when I was saying before the interview, oh my god, I'm so tired. So. Yeah, I definitely got to get my two legs back in shape. So.
And I'm feeling like a cop today. So
lots of arresting.
Officer Purdy, huh? Yeah,
lots of arresting.
It's a good look.
Yeah. Got it from the strip club.
Oh, yeah, all the festivals.
All of them.
You know what? There were so many names. The EDM ones, the country ones. Yeah, no, there were so many names tossed around. I'm not sure exactly what we're doing.
No, we'll be doing all the European festivals when we come back. And some of the state ones as well. So, UK, Europe festivals. We'll see you there. Yeah. I actually got two tracks already.
Yeah?
Yeah. When you do it on iTunes, you already download it now. You get two tracks right now.
Okay.
I have them on my phone. He does not, though.
Nope.
Why not?
I don't know. I didn't.
Because he gives them away to girls.
No.
He gives it away to girls or something.
Yeah.
Like, you buy your records, you give them to your chicks. Yeah,
that's what it is. No, actually, I like actually picking up the physical copy. You know, I usually go and pick up, like, the day it comes out. I hear it a long time ago. Someone told me that was good luck to buy your own record, like, from the store.
I told you. You were doing it on your own?
No. I was instructed to buy my own record, but no, I mean, like, I'm very superstitious, and so I actually like to go and, like, buy it. I don't know. Taking back to
me. No, me too. I think our fans do as well. We put so much effort and time into our packaging and our work as well to have, like, a collectible, tangible item.
Yeah.
I don't know. We're rock fans, so we loved collecting stuff and having stuff, and we still make LPs as well, just because, you know, it's a bigger thing, and I don't think people even know what that means, you know, when they watch us. But there's a record player, it spins stuff, it's made of vinyl. It's just not whatever the shape is, 8x8 or whatever, you know, thing. But
you're talking to my generation.
Yeah. No, I mean, we appreciate all that stuff, and I think our fans do as well, even though they don't know, you know, maybe how we grew up with records, but they appreciate it just for the time we put into the artwork and everything. So yeah, go buy the record, man. There's a lot of cool stuff in there. There's a lot of cool artwork and stuff. So
I have the vinyls of every album, but I don't think I've ever listened to a vinyl. I don't even have a record player, but I have all the records.
I actually have this thing in my house. It's a record player with a CD player and an iPod and a tape, because it's a whole thing. It looks like this old contraption, and it's like a wind-up box on it with a horn, but it actually plays CDs and an iPod. I don't
know. That's sick.
It's pretty cool.
It's going great. I mean, well, obviously we play our lead single. That definitely play that in the set.
It's called Heart of Fire.
Heart of Fire. Yeah, we start the set off with that.
Build your walls, but you can't keep me out. But I'll burn them down.
Faithless. I mean, we have a, well, it's kind of like a lyric video, but it's not. It has no lyrics. It's just, but it's not a music video either. It's just, well, how would you classify it? A motion picture
video.
It's
not a lyric.
There's no lyrics. But yeah, we played that. And so there's definitely a couple songs that people have heard and a couple songs that they haven't heard from the new album. So give them some new material to listen to.
How would you even classify that video?
It's not a music. Well, there's music and it's, I don't know.
We sure did.
Yeah. It was incredible. I mean, we've obviously been influenced by his previous work, you know, Black Album. I mean, who doesn't like it? Well, actually, a lot of people don't like the Black Album. But we definitely love the Black Album, Motley, you know, the Cult, all stuff like that. And so, you know, he definitely has a sound and he was very interested in us. He heard In the End on the radio and got in touch with us to work with us, you know. And so it was very cool working with somebody that we've looked up to and, you know, have always appreciated his work. And so, you know, he was kind of like the sixth member of the band. I know every band says that works with him, but he really was. Like, he wasn't overbearing. He wasn't, you know, too controlling or anything. He kind of let us do what we had to do, but with direction, so.
Yeah, for us, I feel like he was more an orchestrator for this record. I mean, yeah, he produced it, but less of a songwriter. We came in with a bunch of songs that we demoed and did like a lot of pre-production with to figure out what the tone was going to be, right? And so his expertise guided us in the direction that we wanted to go, because we had a lot of meetings first about what the tone was going to be, what we wanted to go with our career and direction and the sound. So he helped us achieve that, you know, through his means. And he had a lot of cool insight for us as far as like songwriting as well, like when we would come up with stuff and he would change this, move this around, or how the song moves, you know. So we kind of pulled back in our tempo a lot and got a lot more groove and feel that we were kind of missing. And it made us as a heavier band in that sense, because you were able to get the tonality of it, a heavier sound, because you're not playing so fast from that. And it, I don't know. So we, when we say heavy to, you know, our audience, it means more in a classical sense, you know, that it's just fucking more grooving and the tonality of the heaviness, not like heavy today where people are just, you know, screaming and shit. So. Right, I mean, Dr. Feelgood and the Black record, I mean, that's our band's favorite records, you know, of all time, you know. He's done so many other stuff. You know, he was a mixer before he was a producer as well, and he did stuff like Loverboy and stuff that we're fans of. You know, we love stuff like Foreigner, Loverboy, Journey, all that kind of stuff as well. You know, it's like anthemic rock stuff, so, you know. And he also mixed our record. I don't know if people know that as well. Yeah. He actually mixed our record. He didn't produce it. He went like full control of this record, so.
Yeah, going into the record, I mean, he asked, like, oh, what guitar tones, you know, do you want to shoot for? And we were kind of like, oh, like, you know, Metallica, Black Album. And then he goes to me, like, what drum tones do you like? I'm like, Black Album, like, what's bigger than that? And he's like, oh, well, I guess I'm your guy then, you know, we were joking about that. But, yeah, definitely, we love the tones, you know. He has, like, a thickness and a low end to it, you know. And so we definitely wanted to achieve that, and I think we got it on this record.
Yeah, I learned stuff just a lot in bass as well. The frequency of bass, he approached it that way, where he was saying, because we're missing a lot of low end in our earlier stuff, where when you solo out stuff on a record, like stuff, it kind of sounds kind of shitty, if you will, right? But when it's as a whole, it sounds good. So you have to find the right frequency, because like he was saying, when you tune the guitars or the drums in this certain place, there's a pocket that he would find, you know, in mixing where the bass would sit, so you can actually hear it, you know. But when it's soloed, it's kind of like, you know, when you want to try everything sounding good when it's soloed, it doesn't actually work as a whole.
Yeah.
So he taught us this thing about just frequency and stuff. It's like, I don't know, he's a fucking awesome music chef.
Yeah, you know, exactly. It's like
took all the right ingredients and like knew how to have all the flavors pop.
Yeah, it's like when you make a cake, you don't put 1 cup sugar, 1 cup flour, 1 cup butter. You know, it's like it's different. You know, like a couple tablespoons salt or whatever. That's how I like record.
Yeah, so he taught us that and stuff. So
he also taught us how to bake a cake.
Well, actually, he did do a lot of cooking for us as well.
Yeah, he did.
Seriously.
Yeah. He doesn't drink, but his margaritas are.
Yeah,
woo,
he made us like his own special margaritas as well. Yeah. Cooked some fillets for us and some tuna steaks and stuff. It's great.
Totally family, you know, and he's a Canadian that lives in Maui, so his disposition is super laid back, is super chill, easygoing, you know, get along with everyone, and his stories about the other bands were great, and you know, his stories even about us, you know, even about us. I mean, we raised hell. We started the album in North Hollywood, California, then we went up to Vancouver, and then back to Hollywood, and we were all over the place, and we were running amok the whole time, so I mean, you know, and hearing his stories and his comparisons with the people he's worked with and us and stuff, and so.
I think, to me, personally, what I learned and got from that, not necessarily the record, but our process as a group, and as in, you know, us together as a band, we had a lot of, I wouldn't say turmoil, but like, you know, there's a lot of growing period between stuff that we learned from each other, you know? I don't know, we came out, anyhow, we came out on the end of all of that at a better place, you know? There was a point of just a lot of struggle between direction and things that we wanted to have happen, you know? So after that, I think it made this record such a better record because of that. Okay. So I'm glad that we had that process or that growing period for me, you know, because now, I mean, we love our record, we love our tour, we love our group, our bandmates, like our team as a whole today because of, you know, coming from Wretched and Divine.
Okay.
So that's where I stand on that.
Yeah, I don't think the band's chemistry has been better than it is right now. Yeah. I mean, we're all getting along like, we've had our ups and downs, but I mean, it's not like this is the first time we've all gotten along, but you know, we all go out to like dinner and, you know, go get drinks or something, which is something, you know, maybe a couple guys would stand back or, you know, hang out. And it wasn't because we had any issues with each other. It's just, that's how it is. So now it's like, we actually all want to hang out. Like, hey, what do you guys want to go? Yeah, let's go somewhere. You know, and it's, I don't know, just hanging out. The morale is really high right now, so.
See, that's kind of what I'm getting at. It's like, I don't know, we've been together since 2009. 5 years is kind of a long time today for groups, and we're sticking around. We're not going away anytime soon. but I don't know, it's, you know, in the beginning when you start a band, it's always about like, you feel great gung-ho with your brothers, your mates, and your friends, you know, and they're like, oh, we're gonna have a band, let's play, have fun, we'll drink, we'll party, and whatever. And that turns into a business, and you have to, you know, have to function, and to figure out how things play in the interpol of his personalities and dynamics and all that kind of stuff. So you go through this thing, and you're growing period, you know, and we're all brothers, we're all family, and so, you know, you have your fights, your arguments, all that kind of stuff, but if you're intelligent enough to grow through that, you grow through that, and you come out on the other end in a good place. So I think that's where we're at, you know, it's like, we went to that point, and at a low point, you know, whatever, we haven't figured it out, we worked it out, and then we come out on the good end, and now we're better than ever, so that's how it is. We're a very healthy relationship right now, you know.
Which is good if you guys
talk it out, communication.
15 months we'll talk about.
Right? Yeah. Like the other day, we were talking about Halloween. I was like, "Oh, I thought we already had a show booked for Halloween." They're like, "No, next Halloween." I'm like, "Holy shit, we're already going there!" Like, it's no joke. This is for real. I'm like, "Oh my god." They're like, "No, 2015."
Yeah. So back to your touring question. Yeah. We're booked until next Christmas.
Yeah.
World tour. So we'll see you guys. We're already booking. So much. I mean, 2009, like anybody, what do you do in 5 years of yourself and your life? I mean, and we've been together like all the time, we've been nonstop touring. So, you know, it's just as people, just general people, not even in a rock band, like just as a person, how much you grow. And then when you have to change and grow and evolve as an individual together, you know, with your mates, like, fuck, so much.
Yeah.
It's tough. I mean, how many relationships fucking last for 5 years, you know, and have to, I have a relationship with four other guys, you know, so
that's like 20.
That's kind of how it works,
right?
You know?
It's like you multiply like five,
right.
Four, 20.
That's 20, dude.
What? Yeah.
Killer.
No, but, you know, it's like also releasing a record almost like every year, you know, we've done EPs and records like every year. So it's like, we're constantly working. You know, it's not very often that we have some.
Yeah, we always put stuff on soundtracks, we have EPs, we have all kinds of other stuff besides, you know, our LPs, so. I think you're done dealing with that. Anymore, I think that gap is, it's narrowed. I don't know, I think, I see more people loving us right now.
Yeah.
When we have meet and greets every night as well, and a lot of new people are coming out. Like, have you ever seen us play before? No. You know, I just discovered you. So that, to me, tells me that our band is growing vastly and wildly. You know, the crowd's growing, ticket sales are growing, you know, album sales are growing. Everything's growing right now, and I think it's for the better. I know. Rock and roll's timeless, man. It's gonna stick around for a long time. Lives on fire.